Thorbjørn and Leif, final stages of the friendship. The following Monday, I was back at school. I met Thorbjørn. The atmosphere was very tense, to say the least. It was obvious that he had lost a lot of the confidence he had had in me. For him, that night had been full of horror, and he had got very little guidance from me. I struggled to restore our relationship, to make everything just as it had been. But intuitively, I knew that there was only one way out of this hell, a new LSD trip. I took steps to set one up. An event that occurred 2 days before the final end of our friendship will convey an impression of that autumn. On Saturday, 27th of October 1984, Thorbjørn and I were to initiate two acquaintances, introducing them to the world of the psychonaut. On his way to our house, Thorbjørn fell from his bike. He arrived in poor shape. His face was very swollen and partially covered in blood. What clearer sign do you need? The universe hides nothing. When we ourselves refuse to face the facts, they're carved in stone for us. But I didn't want to face the facts, and neither did Thorbjørn. The following Monday, Thorbjørn and I had arranged with the school that our class was to have only 3 lessons. We didn't even attend them, so we had an entire day for the only item on our agenda, another LSD trip. As I have already reported, my defense mechanisms prevented me from writing about the negative aspects of what was happening to me. By focusing mainly on my insights, and preferably on more philosophical considerations and ideas, on what I had experienced on the conscious level, I could keep the negative gestalts at arm's length. I simply had to do this to retain my sense of general well-being. It was not until 3 years later that I began to write more systematically about all the negative gestalts without this protective filter. It was during the period September 29th to October 2nd, 1987, 4 days after my first relatively successful real LSD trip, and 2 months before the birth of my daughter, that I compiled an account of what had happened to me since the LSD crash, and began to put into writing all that happened to me since that event. I began to use a new coding system I had devised to keep track of all my inner journeys. 9S refers to my 9th trip, 10S to the 10th, and so forth. S stands for syre, the Danish word for acid. Here's an extract from what I wrote about 10S. The global grid. On my initiative, we're going to try to psychoprocess and release the experiences we've been exposed to on the 7th of September 1984. Our relationship is tense after what has taken place. We take LSD at 8:30 a.m. and about 1 hour later we arrive in my room. The substance now starts working and we smoke a pipe of hashish. Using an accusatory tone, I tell Thorbjørn that he lags behind on the psychonaut's path and that now there's a wide gap between us. Negative energies occupy the room and we decide to go outside, down towards the beach. On the way down, something very strange happens. It is as if what now happens, this event that I can't remember and which I later blame myself for not having recorded on my Walkman, is something that I've experienced before. Apart from this lapse, I stick to a firm rule. The only way of bringing the acid world down to earth is to record it on tape. On this occasion, walking down to the beach, it is as if I can predict every word, everything that happens. Suddenly, lines begin to flow out of Thorbjørn's and my head. It's important to note that he too has this experience. There are 2 lines flowing through each of our heads. One of them, let's call it the X line, runs from one side of the head through the ear into the very centre of the head and out through the other ear. The other line, the Y line, flows from the back of the head through the same centre point in the head and out between the eyes. The 2 lines form a highly accurate coordinate system with angles of exactly 90 degrees. These lines constantly keep our heads in special fixed relationships, so that either our x-axis coincide, or his x-axis coincides with my y-axis, or vice versa. This makes it impossible for either of us to look the other directly in the eye. That is, to maintain the x-x position. If one of us turns his head with the intention of looking the other directly in the eye, the other head invariably turns 90 degrees at the same moment. While this is happening, there's a catastrophic moment. I can't recall what is supposed to happen next. The negative energies around us seem to be getting heavier and heavier. As a synchronicity, excavators and bulldozers are digging up Sarka, our power site. We sit down on a large rock between D1 and my room. The air seems to be throbbing with lines of energy. It occurs to us that this rock is a power site, or a quite special hub, of nucleus. We get up and head home. But suddenly I get a cramp in my leg. I don't remember which. It hurts a lot and makes me limp. Besides, I'm now very confused. I don't know what to do. And I have a bad conscience. I go home and lie on my bed for a while. Now it's about 11:30 a.m. or noon. Thorbjørn goes out and I'm on my own. The feelings and moods from my ninth trip well up inside me. I take a bath and that helps a little. The weather is dull with drizzly rain. Early in the afternoon, we visit Red, the drummer, and have a jam session. I play well without any inhibitions. It is as if all my pain is transformed through the music. Sometimes I stand beside my Marshall amplifier and feel lost to the world. Many years later, Red told me that this session was the greatest performance experience of his life. Music always made me feel strong. That set of drums with Red behind them, the Marshall amplifier, the guitar, the audience, it never failed to fill me with a special power. That evening, I didn't feel too bad. The LSD dose was not very high, my thinking was a bit off target, and the next day was quite okay. It was during this LSD trip that one of the most unpleasant body gestalts, the one I called the thin, taut fibre strings, was reactivated in my psychophysical system. My friendship with Thorbjørn was on the verge of collapse. I had to admit that I had been wrong, and we would inevitably part ways. Nonetheless, I tried desperately to maintain the friendship for a while. But I finally accepted the break, and we went our separate ways. I stayed on in the class for the rest of the year, but our friendship had taken a very strange turn. We still spent a lot of time together at school, and had some exciting common acquaintances and friends. But something had come between us that was very hard to define or resolve. It was difficult for us to look each other in the eye, and it took many years before we were able to have a relaxed conversation. Now I'll go back a bit and consider the state I ended up in after the LSD crash. Before the crash, my inner state was one of joie de vivre and exuberance. The summer of 1984 was especially full of magic and life was just one great adventure. The world was at my feet, exciting, meaningful, beautiful and lots more. Now the pendulum swung to the other side and I experienced the opposite moods. Everything was dull and meaningless. I experienced this at a very concrete level. The colours had lost their luster. It was as plain as that. The crash had taken place in the autumn, but the following summer the contrast was vividly clear. It was as if the whole world had become nothing but a massive spectacle devoid of all content. People were nothing but puppets, though they thought they were people, but for me the illusion was shattered. I had had a peek behind the scenes. I knew that nothing had an iota of meaning. There was no way back to that happy, illusory state where there appeared to be a meaning. In the hands of the layman, LSD can certainly cause serious damage. But when used properly, it can be of enormous benefit in terms of psychic liberation and enlightenment. One of the canards about LSD is that it fries the brain's circuitry. I was convinced that this was what had happened to me. I thought that my brain was irreversibly damaged, and that's a very hard fact to face. The pain was immense and was made even worse by my bad conscience towards my parents. After all, they had spent 17 years rearing a son whom they loved and trusted. And what happens? Just before he should be leaving home and trying his own wings, he fries his brain and causes irreparable damage. I often wanted to die. I wasn't afraid of dying, but I felt a sense of responsibility towards my family. I could sense the pain they would feel if I died. So I put up with my own pain and lived on for their sake. I tried to live like a normal human being, but life had lost its content, apart from a few essential things, which I shall describe later. My physical condition had changed drastically, and there were four gestalts in particular that marked my life in hell.